am I clearly audible? Because okay, fine. Okay, so let's start today's lecture. So we are discussing currently about the propagation of electromagnetic waves in conductors, and in the last class I introduced the. Someone else is trying to join. Just a minute. Yes, so we have introduced the complex wave vector in conductors, where we have shown that the wave vector, which is usually a real quantity in case of plane wave propagation in a vacuum or in a dielectric, becomes a complex quantity in case of conductors. And we solved a quadratic equation in kr square, and basically this was a quadratic equation, so you can easily find out the solution. Simply getting minus a plus minus square root of b square minus by a, where a, b, c are the coefficient in quadratic equation. And we saw that kr comes out to be like this, which depends on permeability, permittivity, frequency of the wave and the conductivity medium. And another thing I forgot, because this quadratic equation, there are two solutions, right? So whenever plus minus b square minus 4a, plus minus sign over there. And we choose the plus sign, the minus sign. Why we choose the minus sign? Because if you choose the minus sign, you see this quantity can be larger than one, and there is a plus one and a minus something other than one, that will be negative. That is achcha na? Achcha. Wait. I mean, abar pure. Okay. Stop. Can everyone see the presentation now? quantity which describes the plane wave propagation in any medium, and this cannot be negative. You see, k is a vector, so it can have a positive or negative sign if you talk, speak in terms of direction. But here we are talking about the amplitude, and what is the amplitude of the wave vector is a unit. If you take k equal to 2 pi by lambda, right? So phase change per unit wave, unit length, so that cannot be negative. So that's why we have not chosen the minus sign here, it's a plus sign, and this is kr. And we also saw that kr and ki, kr is the real part of the wave vector, ki is the complex part of the wave vector, they are linearly related. So we saw that kr ki equal to mu sigma omega by 2 kr. So once you get kr, you can easily calculate ki. So these are the two things which are plays important role in the wave propagation in a conducting medium. So as I told you, the kr represents the usual plane wave propagation, and the complex part ki represents an attenuation of the wave amplitudes, which you have already discussed. Now let me just again repeat it. There is no harm in repeating this one. So we actually defined a quantity called scheme depth, which measures or quantifies the distance over which the amplitude of the electric field or magnetic field falls by a factor of 1 by E inside the conductor. And that is related to ki, the complex part, because we have e to the power minus kiz, where you can write this as a delta I, where delta equal to 1 by ki. We already have the expression for ki, so we substitute it here. And we also know what are the criteria for a good conductor or a poor conductor. So if you apply the criteria for a good conductor, for which sigma by epsilon omega should be much, much greater than one, I remind you again, the criteria for good conductor is basically the free current density should be much, much larger than the displacement current density. And that comes from the Maxwell's equation. So if it is very, very larger than one, then you can simplify this expression easily, because it's very large, then you can drop these factors, one and these things, and simplify it to get ki equal to this one, right? And you flag in this ki here, then you get delta equal to square root of 2 by mu sigma omega. So for a good conductor, we have the scheme depth, which depends on the conductivity of the medium, the frequency of the wave that you have considered, and also the permeability of the medium. So all three factors are important, and based on this you have to analyze a situation. I gave you a couple of example, like the copper wire and the iron wire, if you remember, because iron has a smaller conductivity. So if you choose iron over copper, you will get a larger skin depth. But no, that's not the case, because permeability of the iron is much, much larger than the copper. So that's why you see we choose copper wires in place of iron wires, because if it is very large, then delta will be small and there will be more power loss. So that's why copper wires are chosen. And also I gave you example of a submarine, and so I'm not repeating that once again here. And so for a bad conductor, again I showed you that this quantity should be much, much smaller than one. And if you apply that criteria in this expression of skin depth, you will find out that the skin depth of the medium, that is a poor conductor, it is 2 by sigma square root of epsilon by mu. And the interesting difference between these two are that this is independent of the frequency. It doesn't depend on the frequency. Whichever wave you choose, the skin depth is constant. It depends on the conductivity of the medium, of course, or the properties like permeability and permittivity, but it is independent of any external condition like the frequency of the incoming electromagnetic wave. So that's the difference between a good conductor and bad conductor. Well, so these are some pictures where I saw what skin depth actually means. That's a length scale over which amplitude falls by a factor of 1 by E, or roughly 1/3. And also this is just a cartoon diagram showing you that the amplitude of the wave remains constant when it travels in air or some other medium. But whenever it encounters a conducting medium, the amplitude gradually decays away exponentially. And I also told you the reason behind it, because the conductors contains lots of free electrons, and the electric field of the incoming wave exert force on them, on those free electrons, and they move around, they jiggle around. So there are current, and that current basically takes away energy from the electric incident electromagnetic wave. So naturally the amplitude of the electric field gradually decays away as you go inside the conductor. So that's the physical reason behind this skin effect. Well, so now we want to delve deeper. I mean, the other issue that we want to address here is basically, you see, this is the expression for a wave vector in conductor. That's a complex quantity. And if we want to write down the electric field and magnetic field inside a conductor, we have the usual expression for electric field, which is a plane wave solution, this EZT. So we have considered an electromagnetic wave which is propagating along the plus Z direction. The frequency of the electromagnetic wave, right now we are considering a monochromatic electromagnetic wave, so frequency is omega, wave vector is k. And again, since we are inside a conductor, so it will be a complex quantity. And EZT, the expression for the electric field, is the complex amplitude E0. This can be a complex vector, but here it is a complex scalar, because I have separated the direction or the polarization of the part of the electric field here by denoting it as x cap. So electric field is, suppose, polarized along x direction, and the wave is propagating along z direction. So this part is representing the plane wave variation. That's the phase of the wave. And since we know that the k is a complex quantity in a conductor, we can plug in this kr plus iki inside this expression in place of k, so that then you can separate the complex part here e to the power I thing. Of course, this has complex and real part both, but the one exponential factor which it throws away is e to the power minus ki into z, and which is basically responsible for the attenuation of the electric field. The decrease of the amplitude of the electric field, and that's we have just discussed right now, that's a skin effect. And also you can write down this complex scalar as the real quantity times the phase of the wave e to the power I delta E. Delta E is any initial phase of the electric field is described in this part. So E0 tilde is E0 e to the power I delta E now, and the rest of the quantity remains same. Then we again write down the magnetic field. What is the associated magnetic field with the electromagnetic wave which is propagating inside the conductor along z direction? Well, it is very similar. Again, since the polarization of the electric field is along x direction, So naturally, we know the relationship between K, E, and B. So we can easily figure out what should be the direction of B, that is along y cap. And B0 tilde is the complex amplitude of the wave, which again we can write down this K in, as a combination of real and imaginary parts, which you if you plug in again it throws away an e to the power minus kij factor. And you can also write B0 tilde as B0 e to the power I delta B, where delta B is any initial phase of the magnetic field. So you see delta E is the phase of the electric field, delta B is the phase of the magnetic field. And I have removed tilde here in the last step. You see in both equations, to just write down this real amplitude and these are the phase. This is the skin effect, decrease of amplitude. This is the plane wave variation. This is the polarization. So you see electric field is polarized along x direction. Magnetic field is polarized along y direction. Both the electric field amplitude and magnetic field amplitude gradually decays away as it penetrates inside the conductor. In the same manner, you see that this ki is 1 by delta I or delta equal to 1 by ki. So skin effect is effective in both of them and they have some phase. That's the important thing. So how do I know whether, you see, when I discussed about the propagation of electromagnetic waves in vacuum or in a dielectric medium, I told you that one of the important property of electromagnetic wave in such a medium is that the phase of the electric field and magnetic field, they coincides. That means the maxima and minima of the waves, they happen simultaneously. But will that be the case in a conductor? That we want to figure out, right? So this is the phase delta E. Phase of the electric field, delta B is the phase of the magnetic field. In case of vacuum, we have seen that they are identical, they are in the same phase. What about the conductors? Okay, so let us now figure out that. So this is the same expression that I have written in the previous page, and you know that B and E can be related in this way, where K is the propagation vector. Of course, K is a complex quantity here. It's not a real part only. Both it contains both of them. V is the velocity of the wave. And again, you know, V equal to omega by K. So if I take the amplitude on numerator, so K cap becomes K vector across E divided by omega. Omega is the frequency. Now, you see, this K, now I can write down this because I know the direction of K. The wave is propagating along the plus Z direction. So K must be amplitude K times Z cap. So that I have done here, K vector equal to K into Z cap, fine. And then I have put the values expression for EZT, which was E0 e to the power I delta E into e to the power minus KIZ into e to the power I real part of the wave vector times Z minus omega T. And the polarization of the electric field was along X direction. Since it is K cross E, that's why Z cap cross X cap and omega is in the denominator. Let us simplify it further. So what do I get? We get K by omega, right? E0 e to the power I delta E. All the quantities are same. Only I have written the direction, resulting direction of magnetic field, which is again y cap. We already know that. So z cap cross x cap is y cap. And now you see K is a complex quantity. And you can represent K in the complex plane, that is the argon. You can use argon diagram and write down KR as mod of K cos phi K and KI equal to mod of K sin phi K. And so basically, if you combine these two, you can write K equal to mod of K into e to the power I phi K. And B0 by E0 is mod of K by omega. So if I use this in this expression, the previous line here, you can see now I am writing K as mod K e to the power I phi K. So K is written as mod K e to the power I phi K. Rest of the things are same. E0 is there. You see e to the power minus I KIZ, e to the power I delta is also there. All other quantities are same. Now you see, if I simplify it further, you can see this K by mod of K by omega is B0 by E0. So if I write B0 by E0 in place of this, E0 cancels out. I have only left, I have B0 left here. And the other things are e to the power I phi K, e to the power I delta E, e to the power minus KIZ, e to the power I this phase times Y cap. Now you see, if I start from the first line to last line, if I ask you to compare this expression with the last expression, what do you conclude? You see, this expression tells you that the phase of the electric field is delta B to the power I delta P, right? and the rest of the things are same. E to the power minus ki is here, here also. This quantity is there, here also. Y cap is here. Y cap is here also. So only thing is the this quantity. E to the power I phi k times e to the power I delta I. Here it is e to the power I delta b. So if I compare this first line to last line, what we can conclude that e to the power I delta b equal to e to the power I phi k plus delta I. What does that imply? It implies that the phase of the magnetic field is not necessarily equal to the phase of the electric field. There is a phase difference phi k which you have to figure out for in different situations. So magnetic field and electric field are not in the same phase as it was in vacuum or in dielectric. So that means maxima of electric field may not coincide with the maxima of the magnetic field. There is a phase lag, right? Because you see b delta b is phi k, so the electric field is lagging behind the magnetic field by some angle that we have to figure out. Well, so delta b minus delta e is phi k, which is the phase difference between the electric field and magnetic field inside a conductor. Now let us analyze it situation by situation. So in case of good conductor and then in case of bad conductor, we'll discuss about this. So let us first of all write down the simplified expression for electric field. Once again, it is e0 e to the power minus kiz, and if I only consider the real part of the exponential factor e to the power I krz minus omega t and delta e, if I incorporate all of them inside the e to the power I thing, because if you remember exponential, this is, you see, I am taking this delta b or delta b e inside this exponential factor and then writing the real part only. So that's the cos term, cos kr z minus omega t plus delta e x cap. Similarly, magnetic field is represented by this expression, right? This is the skin part, skin effect part, which is the damping of electric field or magnetic field inside the conductor. This is basically the plane wave variation, right? cos term. Again, you should note here that here the phase is delta e, here the phase is delta b, but delta b is nothing but phi k plus delta e. That's why I have written delta e plus phi k in place of delta b in case of magnetic field, right? And of course the directions are different, x cap and y cap. Now we shall use these two expressions throughout our calculation, right? Because these are the real things which we have to deal with in real life. Fine. So we want to calculate what should be the phase difference between the electric field and magnetic field in a good conductor and in a poor conductor. So let us analyze one by one. So as I have already mentioned, that B0 by E0 is mod k by omega. So mod k, again, you can calculate by taking modulus, that is kr and ki both are known to you. You can just put the values, which I have not written here explicitly, but you can easily do it. You know both kr and ki, just square them, add them, take a square root and divide by omega, you will get this one. This is the amplitude, ratio of amplitude in conductors. But again, depending on the conductivity of the medium, it could be different for different conductors, good conductors or bad conductors, that could be different. So this is the amplitude, ratio of amplitudes, right? B0 by E0, magnetic field amplitude divided by amplitude of the electric field. And for a good conductor, we have already discussed that sigma by epsilon omega must have to be much, much greater than 1. All right, and if you use that condition here, you see sigma by epsilon omega is much, much greater than 1, then again, you can compare the other terms, relevance of the other terms with respect to it, because if it is much, much larger than 1, then square of that quantity must be much, much, much greater than 1. So you can of course drop 1 and then simplify it to get B0 by E0 is equal to square root of mu sigma by omega. So this is the ratio of field amplitudes of magnetic field and electric field inside a good conductor. Now if I consider a poor conductor, in that case it is simple, just opposite, is much, much less than 1. So if it is much, much less than 1, you can simply expand it in Taylor series, because sigma by epsilon 1 is much, much less than 1, the square of that will be of course much, much, much smaller than 1, and if you take a square root of that, you can expand that in Taylor series and simplify it, right? So you can simply drop away this term, because if it is very small, you don't need to even expand it, because you can see sigma by epsilon is much, much lesser than 1, square of that will be much, much lesser than 1, much, much, much. So in comparison to 1, it will be nearly 0. So that's why it is square root of mu times epsilon. And this we already know, because this is nothing but 1 by the velocity, right? That we have seen in vacuum or in case of dielectric and so on. Is the slide visible? Hello?
Yes, sir. Okay, fine.
So these are the ratio of field amplitudes in good and poor conductors. Okay, you have to remember these because these are important things. Whenever you discuss about the propagation of electromagnetic waves in conductors, you have to deal with these numbers. These are very important because we are going to use these numbers again for further calculations. Okay, and I was actually discussing about the phase, which I actually skipped and introduced this ratio of amplitude. So I should continue the discussion on phase thing. So let us go back to phase again. So what is the phase difference, right? Because using the argon diagram, I already showed you this. You see this was the expression for k equal to mod of k e to the power I phi k. So kr is mod of k cos phi k, ki equal to mod of k sin phi k. So if you take a ratio, sin phi k by cos phi k is tan phi k, and this is ki by kr. So that's why I have written here that phi k equal to tan inverse ki by kr. And we want to calculate this in case of good conductor or poor conductor. You see, you already know the expression for ki and kr, for good conductor and poor conductor. So it is just a simple algebraic simplification exercise, nothing more than that. So everyone can do it. So when sigma by epsilon omega is much larger than 1, you see, should I go back again? Maybe I have to change the slide again and again. If sigma by epsilon omega is much larger than 1, then you can look, this is much larger than 1, right? If it is much larger than 1, then basically kr and ki are identical. You don't have to bother about those plus minus factor in those expression. And that's why so kr equal to ki in case of good conductor because of this condition. So if you put ki equal to kr, it is tan inverse 1. So it is telling you that the electric field and magnetic field are having a phase difference of pi by 4 inside a good conductor, right? So that's a conclusion coming out of this analysis. And if you are considering so this is telling again that they are not in phase, that we have already discussed that there could be a possibility that there is a phase difference in conductor, and that phase difference comes out to be pi by 4. So they are not in phase. Fine. What about poor conductor? If you take a poor conductor, I told you sigma by epsilon omega is much less than 1 in case of poor conductor. And again, you can simplify kr and ki. I'm not going back to the same slide again. And again, this is a trivial exercise. Everybody can do it. Just try. If you have any difficulty, I can show you the steps. It's straightforward. So if you just apply this criteria and those expression for kr and ki, you can simplify those and write down kr to be equal to omega times square root of mu epsilon, and ki to be equal to sigma by 2 square root of mu by epsilon. And if you put this expression for ki and kr in the expression for phi k, you get tan inverse sigma by 2 epsilon omega, and that is equal to nearly sigma, since sigma by epsilon omega is much smaller than 1. It's very small quantity in case of poor conductor, so that will be nearly equal to sigma by 2 epsilon omega. And you already know that sigma by epsilon omega is much lesser than 1, so that obviously dividing it by 2, it doesn't change anything. It will be much lesser than 1. So what does it tell you? That will be nearly equal to 0. Very small number, say 0.00000001. So that has no significance at all. So that means, it tells you that the electric field and magnetic field in case of a poor conductor, they are in the same phase. There is no phase difference between them, right? So that's the difference between good conductor and a poor conductor. So phase difference between electric field and magnetic field remains same in a poor conductor. So we have now discussed the ratio of field amplitude and the phase difference between the field components, that is electric and magnetic field. What are the other things to consider? Energy density. We have to discuss about the energy density, that this I have already told you, nearly in phase, nearly because of this sign. I have not written exactly in phase, nearly phase, because it depends again on the how poor it is, poor, because if it is not that much poor, then it will be not exactly in phase, slightly difference will be there. So that's why I have written here nearly in the phase. Fine. Now we shall discuss about the energy density in the electric field and magnetic field. And we have already derived this, that race field, the amplitude of the two field components, this B0 by E0 is square root of mu sigma by omega in good conductor because of this condition that we have applied. And energy density, what is energy density? You know the expression for energy density of electromagnetic fields. So you say we are considering only the electric field component, then the energy density is half epsilon times E square. So I have not derived this expression, but this is straightforward. You must have done this in your electrostatic part of your last semester course. And if you plug in the expression for E, which we have written just two slides before, like this one, this is E0 e to the power minus KIZ cos KRZ minus omega t plus delta E x cap. I am going to use this expression here. So if I put that in place of E, see E0 square, there was e to the power minus KIZ, so 2 will become 2, there will be 2 here, and cos square KRZ minus omega t plus delta E. This is the energy density in the electric field. Well, what is energy density in magnetic field? Similarly, the expression for energy density in magnetic field is 1 by 2 times mu into b square. And we again have the expression for magnetic field of the electromagnetic wave here. The only difference is there, we have a b0 here, right? Not e0. Here it is e0, it is b0. And do you know the relationship between e0 and b0? So we can use that. So I'm going to use this expression for b in that expression of b square. So if you put this B in this expression, you get this one. And since we know that for a good conductor, B0 and E0 are related via this relation. So B0 is what? Square root of mu sigma by omega into E0. So B0 square equal to E0 square times mu sigma by omega. So if I write mu sigma by omega, right? Here. Sorry, it will be opposite. E0 will be there. So omega, sorry, it will be opposite. B0, yes. So B0 will be mu sigma by omega. So if I put it here, mu sigma by omega, mu cancels out. So sigma by 2 omega, right? Yeah, I put it here. B in place of B0 square, it is square root of mu sigma omega into E0. So square it, mu sigma by omega into E0. Mu gets cancelled. So sigma by 2 omega. This is the expression for energy density of magnetic field in a good conductor. See, we are analyzing case by case. This is for good conductor. I mean, things are identical. I mean, this is repetitive because that. So I mean, if I show you one, you can do the other. So it's not much. I mean, it's difficult. So well, then if I take the time average values, because it's a wave, so there is a well-defined time period, and like we average over the time period. So you can see that UE, energy density of the electric field, was this half of epsilon 0 E square and this. So if you square it, right, this is all, so E square is there, so cos square is there. So if you time average, if you take a time average of that, so dt times 0 to t 1 by t, so if you do that, so cos this integral will throw away a factor of half, so this will become 1 by 4. That's why it is 1 by 4 and 1 by 4 epsilon e0 square e to the power 2 ki, and in case of magnetic field, you see this half becomes 1 by 4 by omega. This cos square is half, cos square is not here because we have taken a time average of that. And if we now compare the time average values of energy density in electric field and magnetic field in a good conductor, what is the conclusion? You see, now if you divide time average energy density in electric field by time average density in magnetic field, you see these factors are same, so they get cancelled out. 1 by 4 also gets cancelled out. So it's nothing but sigma by epsilon omega. And which you already know that in case of a good conductor, this must be much, much larger than 1. So this tells us that the energy density, you see, in case of vacuum, if you remember, half epsilon is square, half epsilon naught is square is equal to actually half b square by mu. Let me see, epsilon is there. Right. Typo, got mistake. Again, as I am telling you that I am preparing this lecture within a very short time, right? Kal ratri korechi 2 ghonta moto bosechi tar modhe type korchi bujhte pachho ekhane ele tomar ami kintu tomake pathi dewar pore 2 4 ta bhul theke jete pare. If you notice something, হ্যাঁ, ইফ ইউ নোটিস সামথিং প্লিজ টেল মি, রাইট? ইউ আর কারেক্ট, ইট ইজ সিম্পল, ঠিকই বলেছো, এটা উল্টে গেছে আর কি, ইউবি বাই ইউবি হতে হতো এটা উল্টে গেছে, রাইট? সো ইট ইজ জাস্ট এ সিম্পল মিস্টেক, ফাইন, আই আই উইল কারেক্ট ইট বিফোর মাইন্স সেন্ডিং ইট টু ইউ, রাইট? সো বেসিক্যালি হোয়াট ইজ দিস টেলিং ইউ, আই মিন ইয়া, what he is saying is correct, this UB on the top, so UB by UE, that means that the energy density in magnetic field is much much larger than the energy density in electric field. So the energy density that means it is telling you that the energy is not equally shared between electric field and magnetic field as it was the case in case of vacuum or in case of dielectric. So it's different in case of metal. Magnetic field carries much more energy than the electric field. Now, in case of poor conductor, again, I have not repeated the entire analysis. You have to repeat everything. You see, starting from this, you have to, since you know that the B0 by E0 is different in a poor conductor, so you can again do the same thing. You have the expression for E, UE and UB. Put B0 in terms of E0 using that expression. So for poor conductor, we have B0 by E0 equal to square root of mu epsilon. So if you use this, it will come. The result will tell you that that if you take a ratio between the two, it will come out to be 1. So that means that the energy density of magnetic field and the energy density of electric field, they are equal. That means that energy is equally shared by the electric field and magnetic field in a poor conductor. So these are some important differences that you should keep in your mind. This analysis is quite simple. You just have to put different, criteria for good conductor and bad conductor. That's all. Well, now let us move into pointing vector. So we have discussed about the ratio of field amplitude, the phase difference, the energy density. Now we'll go to pointing vector. So what is the definition of pointing vector? It is 1 by mu into E cross B. Since we have already expression for E and B, so we can just simplify it. Okay, so let us do that. So in case of a good conductor, sigma by epsilon omega is, again, we know that that should be much much greater than 1. And if you put it here, you see, if you put it here, then, so where I'm putting it, actually I have also taken the time average, so I should go back to the relationship between E and B. So we want to calculate E cross B. Let us go back to the expression of E and B, okay, and see what yes, this is E. We want to take E cross B. What is the direction of E? X cap. What is the direction of B? Y cap. So X cap cross Y cap is Z cap. That is fine. And what is B0? B0 and E0 can be related in a good conductor by using which ratio? This one, mu sigma by omega. You can put that. So basically, I want to write everything in terms of E0. So that will be E0 square. That will be e to the power minus 2 KIZ. And there will be cos of this into cos of this. Now suppose I write krz minus omega t plus delta e as alpha, and so I will write cos of alpha, and here cos of alpha plus say phi k, right? And we know the formula for cos a plus b, that is cos a cos b minus sin a sin b. So when you take a product of this into this, there will be two separate separate terms, one containing cos square of alpha, right, into cos phi k minus cos alpha sin alpha into cos phi k. And when you take a time average, so if you integrate cos square, then you get a half, right, together with this cos phi k, that will be left out. And when you take the second term, that is cos of alpha into sin of alpha into cos phi k, that cos alpha sin alpha term will vanish, because you can write down in terms of sin. And if you integrate over that time period, you will get 0 for that term. So that's why the second term is not there. But so cos square will give you a half factor, and cos of phi k will be left out there. So what is cos of phi k? You see, what is cos of phi k? Because in case of good conductor, we have already learned that phi k is pi by 4, right? So since phi k is pi by 4, so I have written 1 over square root of 2 here. Phi k is pi by 4 in case of good conductor, so cos phi k will be 1 by over root over 2. Fine. And see, don't worry about this prefactor here, that comes out from the relationship between E0 and B0, since I have written B0 in terms of E0, so that's why E0 square is there, and this is the just prefactor coming out of the relationship between B0 and E0. And the rest of the things are fine. E to the power minus 2 KIZ, Z cap is the direction, half is coming from the time average. right? So this is the expression for pointing vector inside a good conductor. What about the same in a bad conductor? For a bad conductor, you see sigma by epsilon omega is much, much less than 1. And there is a difference between the relationship between B0 and E0 in case of a bad conductor. If you remember, B0 by E0 in case of a bad conductor was how much? This is a case of a good conductor. For a bad conductor, B0 by E0, I don't remember it. Yeah, square root of mu epsilon. So if you go back to this relation once again, you take E cross B, you have E0 times B0, where B0 can be written as in terms of this one. So B0 will be mu epsilon, square root of mu epsilon into E0. So E0 square into square root of mu into epsilon, if you put it here. And then again, do the same exercise, that is cos of, this is alpha, and cos of alpha plus phi k. You simplify them again, term by term, and multiply, and take and do the integration. You will have a similar outcome. Only difference is that here, in case of a good conductor, phi k was pi by 4. Here, there is almost no phase difference. The phase difference is nearly 0. So in that case, you see cos of phi k, I have written it 1 here, because phi k is nearly 0. So that's why cos phi k is 1, right? And again, this prefactor, square root of this, this is purely coming from the relationship between E0 and B0 in poor conductor, right? Other than that, there is no such difference. So what it is telling you, that you see, you know the significance of pointing vector, energy carried out by the wave per unit area, per unit time, that depends on the conductivity of the medium in case of a good conductor, right? You see, it depends on the conductivity, whereas in case of poor conductor, there is no role of conductivity as such. Also, it is independent of frequency. You see here, it depends on frequency. So those are some subtle differences which you should actually remember. So this is the analysis for pointing vector. Fine, so we have covered almost all the quantities which are associated with electromagnetic wave. So what are the other things that we need to talk about? So we have discussed about the propagation of electromagnetic wave in a conductor. Now, so you see, electromagnetic wave, when we are talking about the propagation of electromagnetic wave in a conductor, we should also discuss about when the wave goes from one medium to other, just like we did it in case of linear material, right? So it may happen that say sunlight is coming and it is traveling through air, and it is incident on a say metallic surface. That means it is going from one medium to other medium. The second medium is metal in that case, in this case, and the first medium is simply air. I mean, you can take any two other examples. They can consider many examples. So here I'm just taking one example, because see, the entire analysis is quite similar, so it will be quite boring. I mean, repetitive thing, because once you learn Maxwell's equation, you know the boundary condition, just apply the condition, the boundary, and analyze the equation. Quite similar. So I will just discuss one particular case here, and that is which you have already discussed, that the when the wave is incident normally on the conducting surface, traveling through a different medium or a vacuum, whatever you consider. I mean, the first medium is not conducting, second medium is conducting. So what will happen at the boundary, how the boundary conditions will get modified in that case, and what will be the conclusion, I mean, from the analysis. So let us do that. Again, I am just reminding you the boundary condition that is already known to you from previous discussion. So the first boundary condition, which tells you that the perpendicular component of the electric field between the two mediums are discontinuous at the boundary, and that discontinuity is given by the free charge density at the interface. Perpendicular component, you can just close your eyes and believe in it. You don't have to bother about it. This comes from the Gauss's law in magnetostatics, and it is a universal law which doesn't change from situation to situation. So B perpendicular 1 and B perpendicular 2, they are same. It's continuous across the boundary. E parallel 1, E parallel 2, this is also continuous. We have discussed about the proofs of the boundary condition. And the last one tells you the parallel component of magnetic field across the boundary is again discontinuous. It depends on the surface current density at the interface. So Kf is the surface current density, n cap is the normal to the surface. And we are going to use the same set of boundary condition here also, because Maxwell's equation doesn't change, right? Maxwell's equation remains same. You are changing the medium, whether it's conducting, non-conducting, vacuum, dielectric, linear, non-linear, whatever you choose. Maxwell's equation remains same. So you, these conditions you can remember, keep in your head and apply depending on the situation. So now let us analyze the situation. If we have a conductor, earlier when we were analyzing case of linear material or dielectric, we just simply dropped these terms. There is no free charge density, there is no free current density at the interface. So things are a bit simpler, because there is no charge density and current density. But in case of conductor, you see, we cannot simply get rid away of these terms, because we know that the conductors basically carry a lot of free charge density, and because of that they can also have free surface current density, right? We cannot drop them here. So let us go modify these equations in case of electromagnetic wave going from a non-conducting to a conducting medium. Again, we are considering the normal incidence. Of course, I can discuss the oblique incidence as well, but again, the whole analysis is quite similar. As you have already discussed it in a previous class, so I am not going each of these cases. I am just discussing one, and you can also, the entire thing will follow. I mean, you can do it yourself. So again, I have not changed the picture here, the same picture, but again, I should remind you, the first medium is non-conducting, second medium is conducting, so I should have put sigma 1 equal to 0 here, sigma 2 not equal to 0 on the other side. So I have not modified the picture itself, so I have written it here in the caption. You can see it, that we are considering a plane wave with frequency omega, which is traveling along the plus z direction. The electric field is polarized along x direction here, and the first medium, it has permeability mu 1 and permittivity epsilon 1. Second medium has permeability mu 2, permittivity epsilon 2. And the first medium is non-conducting, that's why sigma 1 will be 0, and the second medium suppose is conducting, so sigma 2 will be non-zero, and we want to analyze the situation in that case. Again, as you consider the incident wave to be incident on the interface, there will be two possibilities. One is the reflection and the transmission. Now, since it's normal incidence, you can easily see that there are no, see, electric field has no perpendicular component, right? It is tangential to the surface. So the first two boundary conditions are of no use, right? Although you can see that there is an important conclusion coming out of this. E perpendicular 1 is 0, E perpendicular 2 is 0. Of course, there are no perpendicular component of electric field for either incident or reflected or transmitted. Okay, let us first write down the expression for them. So this is the incident wave, electric field and magnetic field. So I have written in a very similar fashion as I did earlier. You can see the first medium is different, so velocity will be different. Naturally, this is V1 and K1. K1 is the wave vector in the first medium, which is non-conducting. So remember, this is a real number. This is not a complex number, right? And the reflected part, that is this one, since reflected part is moving along a different direction, but in the same medium, so velocity will be same, but magnetic field will be different because V is different. So K1 is the incident KI or K1, okay, K1. So this will be minus of K1. If I take the reflected component, you see there is a minus of K1 because it is propagating along the opposite direction as compared to the incident one, right? So there is a minus of K1, right? And magnetic field will be in opposite direction as compared to the incident field because of that relationship between EB and K. So that's why you see B is minus of 1 by V1 because it was in the minus K direction, K1 direction. This was along the K1 direction or along the Z cap. So the electric field and magnetic field for the reflected wave can be written in this way. And remember, both of them are traveling in the same medium but in opposite direction. The medium is same, properties are same, velocities are same, frequency of course remains same for all of them. So here we do not have any we don't need to think about this attenuation or anything because this is a simple non-conducting medium. But as soon as we consider the second part, the medium on the right hand side, that's a conducting medium. We already know that the electric field gets attenuated there And also, I mean, the conductivity, depending on the conductivity and frequency of the wave, things could be different. So in that case, for the transmitted wave, again, the wave vector is K2, it's not K1. And remember, this K2 is not a real number. K1, K1 in both these waves are a real number, but K2 in this transmitted wave is a complex number because of the conducting medium that we have considered on the right hand side. And simply you can write down this, since we don't need to write V here, velocity will be V2. So you can write down that K2 by omega, where K2 is the complex wave vector. Again, it has both real and imaginary part. And omega, of course, is the frequency of the incoming wave. Now, if we apply the boundary condition at the interface, again, we have assumed a very simplified situation where this interface, we are assuming this interface to be z equal to 0 plane. This is xy plane, and suppose this is the origin, so z equal to 0. So all the points here on the surface have different coordinates, x and y, and z 0 for all of them. So I have a graph. Each and every grid points have different x, y values, and z is 0 everywhere in this plane. So now if we apply the boundary condition at the interface between these two medium, that is a non-conducting and conducting medium, then what could we say? We can say that E perpendicular and B perpendicular are 0 on both sides because of this situation that we have considered, because it's in the case of normal incidence, there are no perpendicular component on both sides. So simply, if I equate, you see, this is first medium, this is the second medium. Second medium, we have only transmitted component. First medium, we have incident and reflected component. Since the perpendicular component of all three waves are 0, so 0, 0 equal to sigma f. So it is telling you something. It is telling you that sigma f is 0. Whatever, whether you like it or not, it's telling you sigma f is 0. Look, let us see what is out. And the second one, again, if you apply this is meaningless. I mean, of course, 0 minus 0 will be, of course, 0. Okay. So we only need to focus in these two equations. Let us analyze these two equations here, or the boundary conditions here. That is the parallel component of E and B. Of course, all of the components are parallel since they are tangential to the surface. So let us write down the expression for E and E parallel and B parallel and see what does it tell us. So the first, the third boundary condition tells us that the parallel component of the electric fields on the left hand side in the non-conducting medium will be equal to the parallel component of the electric field in the on the right hand side in the conducting medium. So since we have two waves on the left hand side, one is incident, another is reflected. So we have summed them together, and you see there was e to the power I, this factor was there, e to the power I k1 z minus omega t, right? And this, all this, since z equal to 0, again, life is very simple. We put z equal to 0, all the exponential factors becomes identical on both sides, because e to the power minus I omega t, e to the power minus I omega t, this minus factor will not make any difference, because z equal to 0, all three will be 0. So all the three terms for incident, reflected, and transmitted, they will have a e to the power I omega t term hanging with them, which can be dropped out because they are identical. And we can simply write down E0I plus E0R equal to E0T in case of an interface between a non-conducting and conducting medium. And if we apply the fourth boundary condition, that is this one, you see, remember, this is important, so listen to it. Here you see we have B parallel 1 by mu 1 minus B parallel 2 by mu 2 equal to this one, right? So this is discontinuous across the boundary, right? And depending on the surface current density, it could be different. Now, what is the surface current density? How do we define surface current density? Right? When you define surface current, it's the current crossing per unit length, right? So on the this is current on the surface. Right. So you take a current, surface current, which is propagating along some direction. If you draw a straight line perpendicular to the flow of the current, then it is the current crossing per unit length on the surface. Right. Just like physical three-dimensional current density, JF. How did it define? JF is the current crossing per unit area, right? Perpendicular to the flow of current. So you put an area perpendicular to flow and measure the amount of current which is crossing through that area, and that's a three-dimensional current density, JF. And now in case of interface between non-conducting and conducting media, what would be the free surface current density? Because we know B parallel one will be sum of incident and reflected parallel component of magnetic field of the incident and reflected waves. Sum them together, you get B parallel one. And B parallel two will be the parallel component of the magnetic field of the transmitted wave. Mu1, mu2 of course are known to us, because mu1 is the permittivity of the first medium, which is non-conducting, second one is conducting, so they are different from each other. What about this term? Now this term, if you look at it carefully, then you see what is the most important law in case of a conductor, right? When you take a conductor, we have free charges like electrons, right, which are responsible for current. So since the current is equivalent to flow of movement of charges or electrons, and current and voltage that you know are related by Ohm's law, and we have already discussed the current density is equal to some constant times the electric field, linearly proportional, J equal to sigma times E. Sigma is a constant number, and it's a property of the material which you call conductivity. So J and E are proportional, right? And now you tell me if as you have discussed in case of conductor, what should we expect? We should expect that I have discussed this in the previous class, that because of the Maxwell's equations, what happens, any free charge density inside a volume quickly gets dissipated, right? And we have talked about this relaxation time. Because of that, we have actually, if you remember, divergence of E equal to rho phi by epsilon, where we put rho phi equal to zero, because rho phi is the volume charge density, free volume charge density, which becomes quickly zero because that gets dissipated from the volume, right? And that comes from the equation of continuity, which you have discussed. So I'm not repeating that once again. What I'm trying to emphasize here, that since we are dealing with real life conductors, so how do you visualize a surface, right? No thickness. That's a dramatic simplification. Of course, mathematically you can imagine a surface like that, but in real life, can you imagine a surface of layer of electrons on a conductor? Of course, you can think about that, but again, electron has a finite dimension, right? But again, we are not going into that. So the in practical situation, in case of an ohmic conductor, if you imagine a situation where all the electrons gets dissipated from the volume and comes to the surface, what will be the volume charge density? Tell me, that is zero, that we have already discussed. What will be the free current density? JF, volume current density, J free. If all the free electrons comes to the surface layer, again, so as soon as you say layer, that means it's not a real two-dimensional surface, it has a thickness, right? Unless I say layer, I say just a surface. Surface means it's mathematical things. All the electrons are on the surface. There are no electrons inside the volume. So what will be the free current density, J free? How did I define J free? It is the amount of, what is, how is current? Current is amount of charge crossing per unit time, say del Q del T. But when you take current density, amount of charge crossing per unit time, per unit area, perpendicular to the flow of the current. So if all the charges, free electrons, comes to the surface, and if you want to measure the free charge, free current density inside the conductor, what will be the value? If the flow is entirely confined on the surface, what is the area? Right, you cannot draw an area, right? If the current is purely confined on the surface, not inside the volume, then when you if you divide by zero, area is, there is no area, right? Inside the volume of the current conductor, there is no area. So that means it is telling you that J will be infinity. How can that be? Is it possible? The Ohm's law is telling you that is not possible, because the conductivity is finite. Sigma is not J equal to sigma times E. Electric field is something which you are applying, right? You have some voltage, electric field, and J is a quantity which is the consequence of the application of a voltage or electric field. Now, entire charge comes to the surface, right? That means there is, if J current density becomes infinite, because no charges are living inside the volume, everything gets dissipated away very quickly. So this is a specific case of ohmic conductor that you should remember. because what we have discussed earlier is a general scenario. Like we have a conductor, and there can be different cases, and depending on conductivity or the other properties of the conductor, one can classify them in different way. But right now what I'm talking about, the conductor which obeys Ohm's law, right? And if it obeys Ohm's law, it tells us that there is no way we can have a pure surface current density. If there is a pure surface current density, then the volume current density should go to infinity, which is not possible according to Ohm's law, right? That means surface current density must be equal to zero. So if we accept that, then Kf will be zero. And remember again, this is for pure ohmic conductors, right? That's a real life ohmic conductor which obeys Ohm's law. In that case, Kf equal to zero, because otherwise Jf will be infinity, which is not possible because conductivity is finite.
Abar ektu bolun to seta.
Ha bolchi je conductivity ta tomar finite quantity, kono ekta conductor e infinite, tumi bolte paro perfect conductor conductivity infinite bolte paro, but real life e ki conductivity infinite hoy? Yes or no? I just answer your answer. Conductivity hoy na ebong arekta jinish hocche je इलेक्ट्रिक फिल्ड संगे लिनियरली रिलेटेड थ्रू कंडक्टिविटी एंड कंडक्टिविटी इज फाइनाइट एटा इनफिनिटी होते पारे ना तार में यदि फ्री कंडक्टिव फ्री करेंट डेंसिटी आलोचना माना बाउंड्री कंडिशन सरफेस वॉल्यूम मैथमेटिकल definition, right? Pure surface kichu ekom hoy na jekhane tomar charge gulo ekta surface mane ki surface mathematical surface charge thakte pare na boktobo ta etai je surface current tumi jeta bhabte chaicho that's not a surface, that's a layer, right? So when I write kf in Maxwell's boundary condition, that is zero. That is what I'm trying to say, because unless that is zero, your current density will become, volume current density will become infinite, right? So that is not possible. Conductivity is finite, so that is not possible, right? Unless you allow this to happen, that Kf equal to zero. So in order to happen that, you have to just accept that Kf cannot be a non-zero quantity in case of ohmic conductors. Is that clear?
Okay, sir.
Maybe if not, I mean, if yes, then say yes. If not, then say no, right? Because I'm trying to explain, but maybe everything doesn't reach you instantly. But you can spend some time think it. I told you the logic, right? Because it is all about Ohm's law, right? And the definition of surface current density and the volume current density, right? আমি না জানি বলতে চাইছি, আমি আবার 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 এমফাসাইজ করছি, হয়তো অনেকের মাথায় প্রশ্ন আছে বলছো না, যে যেটা একটা সারফেস কারেন্টের জন্য ইনফাইনাইট হয়ে যাবে, রাইট? কারণ দুভাবে ডিফাইন করা হয়, সারফেস কারেন্টটা ডিফাইন করা হয় কারেন্ট ক্রসিং পার ইউনিট লেন্থ, আর যখন আমরা যে ডিফাইন করি সারফেস, তখন সারফেস ডিফাইন করি যে কারেন্ট ক্রসিং পার ইউনিট এরিয়া। তো যদি পুরো চার্জ লয় যদি ভিতরে চলে আসে, তুমি এরিয়াটা কোথায় ড্র করো? যদি এই কারেন্টটা ফ্লো করছে তার পারপেন্ডিকুলার দিকে, তো যদি পুরো সারফেস চার্জটা চলে আসে, ধরো সারফেসে গা বরাবর কারেন্টটা ফ্লো করছে, তোমাকে বলছি ক্যালকুলেট দ্য কারেন্ট ক্রসিং পার ইউনিট এরিয়া। হাউ ডু ইউ ড্র এরিয়া অন দ্য সারফেস? ট্যাঞ্জেন্সিয়াল তো হবে না, পারপেন্ডিকুলার টু দ্য ফ্লো না? তাহলে কোনো এখানে এরিয়া, ইউ ক্যান ড্র এরিয়া ওয়েন দ্য এন্টায়ার চার্জ ডিস্ট্রিবিউশন কামস টু দ্য সারফেস। দ্যাট ইজ দ্য লজিক বিহাইন্ড ইট, রাইট? সো ইন কেস অফ ওহমিক কন্ডাক্টর, এগেন দিস ইজ এন্টায়ারলি বেসড অন দ্য ওহমস ল, because if you are ready to accept no Ohm's law is violated, then things could be different. I mean, if you agree that no Ohm's law is not mandatory, J equal to sigma e, eta amra dhore nichi tar basis e kotha bolchi ami, right? Otherwise you can think in a different way. Okay, fine. So as soon as you accept that, then you can put the values of B parallel 1 and B parallel 2. See, B parallel 1 is the parallel component of magnetic field on the left hand side, which we have already discussed. This is the magnetic field, you see. In one case it is E0I by V1, E0R by V1 again, and medium is same, so mu1 will be there, mu1 and V1, you see mu1 and V1 are there, the magnetic field of the incident wave and the repeated wave are in opposite direction. That's why this sign is coming. So minus is there, and then right hand side we have only. This B2 is. B1 parallel is the sum of incident and reflected. And since reflected has an opposite sign as compared to the incident, that's why this minus sign is there. And this minus sign will not be there because I am taking this whole thing on the right hand side. That is this one, right? And KF becomes zero. So in this case, we have already seen that transmitted wave, this is K2 by omega, and the permeability of the second medium is mu 2. So that's why K2 by mu 2 into omega is 0 t. Now, if you take mu 1, v 1 on that side, so this will become K2 mu 1, v 1 by mu 2 omega. That's a number. And remember, that's not a real number because mu 1, v 1 are real. Mu 2 also real. Omega also real. But K2 is not real. That's a complex number. So this time, we have a complex number sitting over there. E 0 I minus E 0 R equal to mu 1, v 1, K2 by mu 2 omega times E 0 T. Let us call that beta. Okay, so this is the first equation, E0i plus E0r equal to E0t, and in this case E0i minus E0r equal to beta times E0t, right? And now we just have to solve these two equations. That's straightforward. So beta is this, right? So if we solve this, the solutions are quite similar. Only difference is beta is complex here. That you should remember, beta is complex here, right? And what are the consequences of that? If beta is complex, of course you can again simplify, put the values of beta. You can, how do we calculate reflection coefficient and transmission coefficient? Again, you have to divide the intensity of the reflected wave by the intensity of the incident wave, which is half epsilon e square times velocity, and same for reflected and transmitted, right? So you know E0i, E0r, E0t, because E0r and E0t are represented in terms of E0i. So you can just put those values and simplify it and then take the real part to get the transmission coefficient and reflection coefficient, which I have not done in this slide. Because of it's just simple algebraic exercise. You just do the same thing which you have done earlier. Only thing is beta is complex. And what is beta? Beta is this one. Okay, so beta is known to us. And what is K2? K2 is Kr plus Iki. Okay, you know the value of Kr, you know the value of Ki, put them, simplify them, you get something. So, okay, so that's why I have not done this. I just want to give you a brief idea of the most important thing that should be taken as a take-home message. I mean, analysis, and if you do it, simplify it. So, I'm just telling you what are the outcome of this analysis. So, suppose I'm taking a perfect conductor. Okay, perfect conductor, of course, sigma to infinity. Okay, if you don't believe in perfect conductor, do the analysis. I mean, write down beta explicitly and take the real and imaginary part. Again, it will lead you to similar conclusion. So no new physics will be learned. That's why I have not done it here, but everybody can do it. Right? So here I am talking about perfect conductor for which sigma 2 tends to infinity. Tends to, again, I am not written equal to infinity. Very good conductor, sigma 2 tends to very large number. Right? Say 10 to the power 20, 10 to the power 23 electron per meter cube. That's a very large number. Of course, 10 to the power 20, 10 to the power 23 is a very large number. So in that case, what are the K2 and so what are the K2? K2 is basically wave vector, complex wave vector in the conducting medium. And it can have two components, real component and an imaginary component. And we have learned already that in case of a good conductor, this real component and the imaginary component of the wave vectors are identical. Because of that condition, sigma epsilon by mu, that condition. What are the condition? This conduction current density and let me take you there. This is the condition for good conductor. If you plug in this sigma by epsilon omega much greater than 1, then you can write this. So this is a specific case for good conductor. So then we have already these expressions are already derived in the previous class. Kr and Ki. So K2 simply tells you the second medium for which the permeability is mu 2. It's conducting. That's why conductivity is sigma. And if sigma 2 tends to infinity, it is telling you that both the real component and the imaginary component of the wave vector tends to infinity. If they should tend to infinity, then what is the implication of that? You see, if this tends to infinity, what is beta? Beta is mu 1 v 1 k2 by mu 2 omega. And since k2 tends to infinity, of course beta tends to infinity. I mean, of course, sigma 2, they are linearly connected. Sigma is connected to K2, K2 is connected to beta, and if one becomes infinity, everything becomes infinity. So if beta tends to infinity, You see, put it here. So it is telling you, if you have a perfect conductor, there will be no transmission. You see, this is simply zero, no transmission. Whereas if you take limiting value here, you will see that the entire incident light will be reflected back. That is the case of perfect conductor. Of course, there is no such perfect conductor in real life. You should actually analyze the situation to get what should the value. You will see that, of course, in that case, you see, for a perfect conductor, since E0T equal to 0, E0R equal to E0I, and we already know what the definition of reflection coefficient and transmission coefficient. That's the ratio of intensity in the reflected and incident wave. And transmittance is the ratio of intensity on the transmitted wave divided by incident wave. So in this case, since there are no transmitted wave, so E0T is 0, E0T is 0, that's why T is 0 and R equal to 1. If you take a real life conductor, this may come out to be 0.9999 and this will be 0.0001. Again, I have not done that analysis. I'll leave it for you, do it and simplify and get the expression for that. Because the physics is not going to change, and it's the same thing happening here. So there is no transmission and complete reflection. Possibly I mentioned about this in the first or second class, where I talked about a mirror, right? How do you design a mirror? Mirror is a glass slab, right? It's a simple glass slab. And I also calculated the reflection coefficient for a glass slab. If light is coming from air to glass, what is the reflection coefficient? It is around 0.04. That means only 4% light should be reflected. So you cannot have a mirror with a glass slab. You must have to have some kind of other material put together with glass in order to create a mirror. And that is done with the use of a very good conductor. You need a very good conductor. If you use a very good conductor, excellent conductor, that means conductivity is very high, and it guarantees that there will be no transmitted component. Entire light will be reflected, right? So for glass we have R equal to 0.04, right? And if you take an excellent conductor like, say, silver, right? And silver has a skin depth of around 100 angstrom at optical frequencies, the kind of frequency that we see with our naked eye, right? So because I have already shown you that the skin depth also depends on the frequency omega, that you should not forget. It is not something, it's a fixed number, right? It's not something a fixed number. The silver region angstrom sob somoy tai hobe na, depending on frequency it changes. So for optical frequencies, the skin depth is around 100 angstrom. Imagine how much one angstrom is around 10 power minus 8 centimeter, right? You have an intuitive feeling of what a centimeter, how long a 1 centimeter should be. So if I put a 10 to the power minus 8 centimeter here, it becomes 10 to the power minus 6 centimeter. So within a length scale of 10 power minus 6 centimeter, the electric field of the incident wave is reduced by a factor of 1 by E. That is what skin depth is all about. It is telling you that there will be no transmitted wave within a very short distance. Entire light will be reflected, right? Because as soon as it tries to go inside the very good conductor, it will be reduced to zero. Electric field amplitude will be reduced to zero nearly. So there will be no transmitted component. And the most important thing is here, the very small skin depth of good conductors. For this particular example, delta is 10 power minus 6 centimeter. Now imagine how many mirror you can create by simply 1 gram of silver. If you melt the silver and paint on the backside of many glass slab, you see, you need a thick layer of thickness 10 to the power minus 6 centimeter. So 1 gram is sufficient for painting, say, hundreds of mirrors, right? So you can create excellent mirror with a very cheaper cost. Whereas if you want to create or construct a mirror using a bad conductor, the mirror will be very heavy, because suppose the skin depth is, say, 5 centimeter, right? So if you put a metallic slab of thickness 5 centimeter on the back side of a glass slab, imagine how heavy that mirror will be, right? So that's why you need a very good conductor in order to construct a very good mirror, right? So essentially, it's all about skin depth, and it ensures that a very thin coating of a good conductor like silver on a glass is capable of reflecting back the entire incident radiation, right? So this is the working principle of a mirror, right? And it entirely depends on the Maxwell's equation and the boundary condition at the interface. Now the other things which I can continue to discuss about is the oblique incidence. And there is no new physics. Everything will be just basically algebraic simplification. So I think that is not necessary, because what I tried to give you a brief recapitulation of the fundamental basic ideas of electrodynamics and certain specific solutions of Maxwell's equation in different conditions. I think I have covered that, right? Of course, you can go to more detailed things, which is definitely not the goal of the present course, because we are left with very small amount of time, maybe 2-3 months, and we have to cover a huge syllabus. So I am not planning to cover any more from the previous semester thing. If you need to understand certain topics, of course I can come back again once I make a significant progress in the course that we are supposed to complete in the current semester. So from the next day onwards, I will start relativistic electrodynamics. That will be the first portion of our course, MPC 3.2, and then as we progress, we will see that how much time we have in our hand. Then if you need anything else to be discussed, I can come back, right? Well, but not right now. Other thing I should mention, you should actually touch upon, is the polarization of electromagnetic wave, which possibly you have already learned in your optics course as well. But certain things like Stokes parameters for characterizing polarization, these should be actually you should be familiar with these things, which I'm not sure whether you have already covered in your previous. As you told that, the last semester you have not gone beyond Maxwell's equations. So I think
reflection coefficient 0.96.
হ্যাঁ কোনটা বলতো
রিফ্লেকশন কোএফিসিয়েন্ট
আচ্ছা দাঁড়াও তুমি যেটা বলছো এই আরটা হচ্ছে 0.04 গ্লাস স্ল্যাবের জন্য ঠিকই বলেছো গ্লাস স্ল্যাবের জন্য কিন্তু এটা পিওর গ্লাস স্ল্যাব যদি না হয় যদি ভ্যাকিউম থেকে লাইট আসে যদি গ্লাস স্ল্যাবে পড়ে তুমি ঠিক বলেছো যে আরটা যদি 0.04 হয় তাহলে আর প্লাস টি ইকুয়াল টু 1 হয় ডেফিনেটলি 96% লাইট ট্রান্সমিট করে যাবে আর আরটা যেটা বলছে যে 4% লাইট রিফ্লেক্ট করবে কিন্তু আমি যেটা বলার চেষ্টা করলাম এখানে যে যদি তুমি শুধু গ্লাস স্ল্যাব না নিয়ে তা গ্লাস স্ল্যাবটার একটা সাইডে যদি তুমি যেটা থিন একটা খুব এক্সেলেন্ট কন্ডাক্টরের কোটিং দিয়ে দাও তাহলে এই আরটা 0.04 থাকবে না রাইট এটা আমি জাস্ট এক্সাম্পল বলেছি এখানে এই অ্যানালিসিস থেকে আরটা 0.04 আসেনি আমি জাস্ট রিমাইন্ডিং ইউ এই পার্টটা আমি আগে করেছি আগে 2-3টা ক্লাস আগে আমি আলোচনা করেছিলাম যখন আমি প্লেন ওয়েভ প্রোপাগেশন ইন মিডিয়াম করেছিলাম ডাইলেকট্রিক মিডিয়াম বা লিনিয়ার মিডিয়াম তখন বলেছিলাম যে গ্লাস স্ল্যাব নিলে তখন রিফ্লেকশন কোএফিসিয়েন্টটা 0.04 হয় কিন্তু এই কেসে হবে না এই কেসে আটটা 1 হচ্ছে পারফেক্ট কন্ডাক্টরের জন্য অফকোর্স যদি পারফেক্ট কন্ডাক্টর না নাও তুমি বলো না আমি ইনফিনিটি করবো না ওকে ফাইন করো না বিটার জায়গায় বসাও বসিয়ে সিম্পলিফাই করে রিয়েল পার্টগুলো বার করে দেখবে আটটা খুব লার্জ হবে রাইট আটটা খুব লার্জ হবে এবং নিয়ারলি 1 ক্লোজ টু 1 মানে পারফেক্ট কন্ডাক্টরের জন্য এটা 1 হচ্ছে ওখানে 1 না হয়ে 0.999 সামথিং হবে তার মানে ট্রান্সমিটেড লাইটটা খুব ছোট হবে এই এই আর এর ভ্যালুর সঙ্গে এটার সঙ্গে কোনো সম্পর্ক নেই রাইট মেবি আই শুড মেনশন দ্যাট ফর গ্লাস বলেছি মানে এটা ফর গ্লাস পিওর গ্লাস এখানে কিনা কোনো মেটাল ফ্যানেল কিছু নেই তার সঙ্গে যখনই আমি একটা কন্ডাক্টর জুড়ে দিচ্ছি পিছনে তখন আর সেটা তো আর মানে গ্লাস সিস্টেম হলো না গ্লাসের সঙ্গে একটা কন্ডাক্টর তুমি জুড়ে দিলে রাইট তখন আরটা পাল্টে যাবে হ্যাঁ তখন তুমি তোমার ডিপেন্ড করবে যে সিগমা টু এবং বিটার ফ্যালটা কি হবে তার উপর ডিপেন্ড করবে আরটা কত হবে সেই এক্সাক্ট ভ্যালুটা আমি এখানে ক্যালকুলেট করিনি আমি সিগমাটা ইনফিনিটি ধরে এখানে আরটাকে 1 দেখিয়েছি ঠিক আছে Am I clear? Hello?
Okay, sir.
তোমার প্রশ্নটা কি আমি আচ্ছা ঠিক আছে তাহলে আমরা এই এখানে এখানেই মানে থামছি কারণ এই এই সেমিস্টারে যেগুলো কভার করার তোমার এরপরেও কিছু জিনিসপত্র রয়েছে তোমার সিলেবাসে ছিল লাইক ওয়েব গাইড পোলারাইজেশন ডিসপারশন এগুলো পুরোটা কভার করতে গেলে আমাদের এই এই কোর্সটা মানে খুবই হেভিলি সাফার করবে রাইট কারণ এই আমি আশা করবো দেখো আমাদের এই সেমিস্টারে যেটা বেসিক নলেজ লাগবে ইলেকট্রোডাইনামিক্স ম্যাক্সিমাম ইকুয়েশন ভালোভাবে জানতে হবে তার সলিউশনগুলো জানতে হবে বাউন্ডারি কন্ডিশন এগুলো ভালো বুঝতে হবে, কিন্তু মানে এই যে আদার থিংস যেটা তুমি বললাম যে ওয়েব গাইড বা ডিসপারশন, এগুলো সবগুলো যে এখনই লাগবে তার কোনো মানে নেই। হ্যাঁ, কারণ রিলেটিভিস্টিক লোটার আইন ইস মোস্টলি বেসিক্যালি কানেকশন বিটুইন রিলেটিভিটি অ্যান্ড ইলেকট্রিসিটি ম্যাগনেটিজম, আর রেডিয়েশন পার্টটাতে বেসিক্যালি তোমার রিলেটিভিটি লাগে প্লাস তোমার মানে বিভিন্ন মিডিয়ামের প্রপার্টি, সেখানে ডাইপোল মাল্টিপোল আমরা যখন আলোচনা করবো মাল্টিপোল রেডিয়েশন বা ডাইপোল রেডিয়েশন, সেখানে আমাদের এইগুলো খুব বেশি লাগবে না। বেসিক আন্ডারস্ট্যান্ডিংটা জরুরি আমার মনে হয়, সেটা আমরা কভার করে নিয়েছি। এরপরে যদি তোমাদের কোনো পার্টিকুলার এরিয়া থাকে যেটা তোমরা ভালো করে কভার করা হয়নি বা জানতে চাও, আই ক্যান ডু দ্যাট বাট নট রাইট নাও। তাহলে আমরা নেক্সট ক্লাস থেকে শুরু করতে যাইছি রিলেটিভিস্টিক ইলেকট্রোডাইনামিক্স। ঠিক আছে
স্যার,
তোমাদের যে কোনো, হ্যাঁ বলো বলো, শুনতে পাচ্ছি।
আজকেরটার উপরে একটা সমস্যা আছে, সমস্যা মানে কনফিউশন, কনফিউশনটা হলো যে যখন একটা ইএম ওয়েভ মানে ভ্যাকিউম কন্ডাক্টিং সারফেসে এসে পড়লো, হ্যাঁ সারফেসে ঢোকার মানে সারফেসটাকে পেনিট্রেট করার পরে যে ফেস চেঞ্জ হলো, যে ই ফিল্ড আর বি ফিল্ড এর যে ফেস চেঞ্জ হলো বা অ্যাম্পলিটিউডটা চেঞ্জ হলো, এই চেঞ্জটা কি অ্যাব্রাপ্ট মানে যেই সারফেস থেকে চেঞ্জ করলো আর অ্যাব্রাপ্ট চেঞ্জ হলো, নাকি চেঞ্জটা কন্টিনিউয়াস হতে থাকে?
না, যেটা গ্র্যাজুয়াল, কখনোই অ্যাব্রাপ্ট কিছু চেঞ্জ হয় না। দেখো আমরা যখনই সারফেস ম্যাথামেটিক্স, আমরা সবসময় সারফেস লাইন এগুলো হচ্ছে আইডিয়ালাইজ সিনারিও, রাইট? একটা বাউন্ডারি সারফেস, আমরা যখন ম্যাক্সিমাম বাউন্ডারি কন্ডিশনটা বার করি তখন আমরা একটা সারফেস ইমাজিন করি, তাই তো? যেখানে সারফলি বাঁ দিকে এই মিউ এপসিলন, ডান দিকে এই মিউ এপসিলন, এরকম তো মানে ড্রাস্টিক চেঞ্জ মানে ওরকম সারফেস বলে কি ম্যাথামেটিক্যাল সারফেস তুমি যখন রিয়েল লাইফে ডিল করছো, তুমি অলরেডি মেনশন দ্য স্কিন ডেপ যখন আমরা আলোচনা করলাম, তার মানে আমাকে দেখলাম যে হঠাৎ করে মেটার ঢুকলে কি ভ্যানিশ হয়ে গেল ইলেকট্রিক ফিল্ডটা, হলো না তো? তার মানে ইলেকট্রিক ফিল্ডটা এনকাউন্টার করছে কন্ডাক্টরটাকে, কন্ডাক্টরের একটা প্রপার্টি আছে, কন্ডাক্টরের প্রপার্টিটা কি, কন্ডাক্টর কন্টেন্টস লটস অফ ফ্রি ইলেকট্রন। তাহলে যখনই একটা ইনকামিং ইলেকট্রন ম্যাগনেটিক ওয়েভ এসে কন্ডাক্টরে পড়বে, তার যে অসিলেটিং ইলেকট্রিক ফিল্ডটা একটা টাইম ভ্যারিং, তাই তো? কস ওমেগা টি সাইন ওমেগা টি ভ্যারি করছে টাইমের সঙ্গে সঙ্গে, তাহলে এই অসিলেটিং ইলেকট্রিক ফিল্ডটা কি করবে, না সারফেসে যে ইলেকট্রনগুলো রয়েছে সারফেস বা ভলিউম যাই ভাবতে পারো, একটা লেয়ার ভাবতে পারো, তার উপরে যখন সে পড়বে তখন তার মানে ইলেকট্রনগুলোর উপরে ফোর্স অ্যাপ্লাইড হলে তার মানে কি হবে, ইলেকট্রনগুলো মুভ করবে, যে কোনো ইলেকট্রন একটা মাস রয়েছে মুভ যদি করতে হয় তাহলে কিছু এনার্জি খরচা হবে, এই এনার্জি খরচা হওয়ার জন্য ইলেকট্রিক ফিল্ডটা উইক হয়ে যাচ্ছে। তাহলে এটা কি মোমেন্টারি হঠাৎ করে পড়লো আর সঙ্গে সঙ্গে জিরো হয়ে, তা তো হবে না। তোমার তার মানে কি মেটালের মধ্যে ঢোকার চেষ্টা করছে, বাট সিন্স দেয়ার আর লটস অফ ফ্রি ইলেকট্রনস দে আর কনজিউমিং দ্য এনার্জি অফ দ্য ইনসিডেন্ট ইলেকট্রোম্যাগনেটিক রেডিয়েশন, অ্যান্ড হাউ ফাস্ট দে উইল কনজিউম দ্য এনার্জি দ্যাট ডিপেন্ডস অন হাউ মেনি ইলেকট্রনস দেয়ার আর অন দ্য সার্ফেস অ্যান্ড হোয়াট ইজ দ্য ফ্রিকোয়েন্সি অফ দ্য ইলেকট্রোম্যাগনেটিক ওয়েভ, হাউ ফাস্ট দ্য ওয়েভ ইজ অসিলেটিং, দিজ আর দ্য টু ইম্পর্টেন্ট ফ্যাক্টর দ্যাট উই শুড রিমেম্বার, রাইট? সো ওয়েন ওয়েভ ইজ ইনসিডেন্ট অন দ্য সার্ফেস it doesn't go abruptly to zero, right? It is a continuous variation, gradually the field amplitude decays away, that's why there is a length scale associated with it which we call delta, skin depth, right, over which the field amplitude reduced by a factor of 1 by e or roughly 0.3 times the original field amplitude. Tomar proshno ta ki ami address korechi na onno kono proshno tomar?
এবার স্যার আর একটা জিনিস ছিল যে যদি এবার ওয়েভটা সাপোজ ওই কন্ডাক্টিং মিডিয়ামটাকে পেনিট্রেট করে গেল, পেনিট্রেট করে ওই কন্ডাক্টিং মিডিয়ামের বাইরে আবার ভ্যাকিউম আছে, হ্যাঁ তখন তো আবার সেখানে গিয়ে তাদের ফেজ দুটোকে সেম হতে হবে এবং ওই
অ্যাম্পলিটিউডটা সেম হতে হবে। গুড কোয়েশ্চেন, ভেরি গুড কোয়েশ্চেন, রাইট? সো দেখো তার মানে ঠিকই বলেছো, ওই তো বলছি যে কন্ডাক্টরের মধ্যে তো ফেজটা পাল্টে যায়, হ্যাঁ। ফার্স্ট অফ অল তুমি যদি রিয়েল লাইফে দেখো, তুমি যেটা বললাম তোমার চোখের সামনে এক্সাম্পল রাখা আছে যে 10^-6 সেন্টিমিটার যদি সাফিসিয়েন্ট হয় একটা একটা মানে ইলেকট্রিক ফিল্ডকে রিডিউস করে দেওয়ার জন্য জিরোর কাছাকাছি, তাহলে তুমি কত থিন, তুমি আইডিয়ালি ভাবতেই পারো যে আরো থিন আমি করবো, 10^-4 সেন্টিমিটারের থিন একটা লেয়ার বানাবো, বানাতেই পারো, ফাইন, রাইট? তাহলে যেটা হবে ডেফিনেটলি ফর এ ভেরি শর্ট স্প্যান অফ টাইম অর ভেরি শর্ট স্প্যান অফ লেংথ, মানে দেখো একটা 10^-4 সেন্টিমিটার যদি থিক থিন লেয়ার ভাবি একটা মেটালের, তার মধ্যে ওয়েভটা ডিপেন্ডস অন দ্য ফ্রিকোয়েন্সি কত ওয়েভটার, তার মানে তার মধ্যে আমরা জানি যে গুড কন্ডাক্টর হলে ই আর বি এর যে ফেজটা সেটা π/4 তফাৎ হয়, তার মানে একটা ফেজ ডিফারেন্স তৈরি হয়ে যায়। অ্যাগেন ওয়েন ইউ গো ফ্রম কন্ডাক্টর টু সে এয়ার অর ভ্যাকিউম, ডেফিনেটলি দেখো ম্যাক্সওয়েলস ইকুয়েশন ভায়োলেট করার কোনো জায়গা নেই, right? It is just written on a stone. Nobody can change it, right? So as soon as you go from conductor to vacuum or air, the phase between E and B will be readjusted to the same. So E and B will be again on the same phase. The difference will be only inside the conductor, not in any other medium like linear material or vacuum, air, anything. So whatever difference between phase there will be between E and B will be in only inside the conductor. But as again I told you that J khub choto ekta length scale sufficient ekta electric field ke puro puri attenuate kore nawar jonno. Sutrang eta niye bhabte hobe na, tumake penetrate kore chole jabe, chance very com nei bolle chole. So tai tu
radio wave nei tale shekhetcho to penetrate korbe, ami ha nilam na shekhetcho to significant amount
রিভার্স করতে পারি যে আলোচনাটা করলাম আমি একই জিনিস, আমি যদি ইলেকট্রোম্যাগনেটিক কন্ডাক্টর থেকে এয়ারে যাই বাউন্ডারি কন্ডিশন পাল্টে যাবে হবে না, তখন ইনসিডেন্ট ওয়েভ আর রিফ্লেক্টেড ওয়েভ যে মিডিয়াম দিয়ে যাচ্ছে সেখানে কেটুটা কমপ্লেক্স, কিমানটা কমপ্লেক্স হবে, এটা কমপ্লেক্স, এটা কমপ্লেক্স, এটা কমপ্লেক্স নয়, তাহলে এয়ারের মধ্যে স্কিন ডেপ্থ হতে যাবে। তুমি খুব সিম্পলিফাই উল্টে দিচ্ছ, উল্টে দেওয়া নয়, যখন কন্ডাক্টর থেকে ভ্যাকিউমে আসছে বা এয়ারে আসছে তখন ইনসিডেন্ট ওয়েভটা যেটা কিনা কন্ডাক্টরের মধ্যে প্রোপাগেট করছিল, এসে ইন্টারফেসে পড়লো, এয়ারে যাওয়ার চেষ্টা করছে, সেই ওয়েভটা যে প্রোপাগেট করছে তার ওয়েভ ভেক্টরটা কমপ্লেক্স, নট দ্য ওয়ান হুইচ ইজ ট্রাভার্সিং থ্রু দ্য এয়ার, ইট ইজ অপোজিট, রাইট? সো বাউন্ডারি কন্ডিশন, ম্যাক্সওয়েলস কন্ডিশন পাল্টাবে না, এগুলো পাল্টাবে না, কিন্তু তখন ইওয়ানটা হয়ে যাবে ট্রান্সমিটেডটা, মানে এখন যেটা ট্রান্সমিট ভাবছিলাম, তখন এখানে তোমার কি থাকবে, ইনসিডেন্ট আর রিফ্লেক্টেড দুটো পার্ট থাকবে, কন্ডাক্টরের মধ্যে যাচ্ছে, তখন তখন আমরা এখন কি করছি, ইওয়ানটাকে করছি এয়ারে করছি, এটাকে করছি কন্ডাক্টরে করছি, তখন এইটা হয়ে যাবে কন্ডাক্টরে, এটা হয়ে যাবে এয়ারে, রাইট? সেকেন্ডটা, সুতরাং এই কন্ডিশনগুলো পাল্টাবে না, পাল্টে যাবে এই এক্সপ্রেশনগুলো, এই যেটা এখানে লেখা আছে এগুলো পাল্টে যাবে, রাইট? কোনটা কমপ্লেক্স কোনটা রিয়েল হবে তখন এখানে পাল্টে যাবে, তখন এটা রিয়েল হবে, এগুলো কমপ্লেক্স হবে, এই দুটো কমপ্লেক্স, এটা রিয়েল, ঠিক আছে? করে দেখো, একটা সিম্পল ট্রিভিয়াল এক্সারসাইজ, রাইট? ফেজ ডিফারেন্স উইল বি এগেইন, দ্যার উইল বি নো ফেজ ডিফারেন্স অ্যাজ সুন অ্যাজ ইউ এন্টার ইনটু দ্য ভ্যাকিউম অর এনি আদার লিনিয়ার মিডিয়াম, দ্য ফেজ ডিফারেন্স উইল বি ওনলি ইনসাইড দ্য কন্ডাক্টর, নট ইনসাইড দ্য লিনিয়ার মিডিয়াম। আর স্কিন এটা, হ্যাঁ বলো,
এই ফেজ ডিফারেন্সের কম্পেনসেশনটা হবে কোথায় যখন মেটাল থেকে এয়ারে যাচ্ছে?
না না,
আমার কোশ্চেন কম্পেনসেশন পয়েন্টটাকে নিয়ে।
ভাবতে পারো, কিন্তু যখন গো ফ্রম, আমরা যখন যে কোনো মিডিয়াম বলছি, একটা মিডিয়াম থেকে আরেকটা মিডিয়াম যাচ্ছি, আমাদের যে পুরো অ্যানালিসিসটা সেটা বাউন্ডারিতেই তো আমরা হোল্ড করছি, যে আমাদের ফেজ, তুমি বলবে কোনাটা কোথা থেকে শুরু হচ্ছে, ধরো আমি বললাম জিরো থেকে, ধরো একটা এক্সাম্পল নেওয়া যায়, জিরো থেকে 5 সেন্টিমিটার এয়ার রয়েছে, 5 থেকে 7 সেন্টিমিটার কন্ডাক্টর রয়েছে। এখন তুমি যদি বলো যে 5.1 থেকে কন্ডাক্টর আছে, কি আমি ফাইভ মানে ফাইভই বলছি, ইয়েস, ফেজ ডিফারেন্স যেটা আমার ফেজ ডিফারেন্স যেটা 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 ডিফারেন্স তৈরি হবে, দ্যাট উইল হ্যাপেন অনলি অন এট ফাইভ অ্যান্ড ইট উইল ভ্যানিশ এট সেভেন, রাইট? কন্ডাক্টর যেখানে পর্যন্ত স্প্যান করছে, অফকোর্স যে ফেজের ল্যাগ যেটা তৈরি হবে সেটা পিওরলি ডিউ টু দ্য ফ্রিজেন্স অফ দ্য কন্ডাক্টর, ওয়ান্স ইউ হ্যাভ নো কন্ডাক্টর অ্যাগেন দে উইল কাম টু দ্য সেম ফেজ, হ্যাঁ, সেটা অ্যাব্রাক্টলি হবে।
হ্যাঁ ঠিক আছে,
ওকে, এনি আদার কোয়েশ্চেন? ওকে, ইফ নট দেন লেট আস স্টপ হিয়ার অ্যান্ড উইল কন্টিনিউ আওয়ার ডিসকাশন ইন দ্য নেক্সট ক্লাস, থ্যাংক ইউ।